back in person, and they're like, okay, okay, this is not my fault, I guess. So I can... Okay, so it's really a pleasure to be back in person, and thank you very much for the invitation. I hope that this talk will be the first of like a new series of in-person talk without any stop anymore. And so in this seminar, I'm gonna discuss a bit regarding the ISM evolution. And I try to give some ideas regarding the way to disentangle the complexity of the ISM, because the ISM is really like a tough matter, let's say. So let's start. With some questions. So all my talk will be basically focused on three big questions that I will try to address. The first one is, what are the differences between the ISM properties in local galaxies and high redshift galaxies? The second one is, what are the implications for the star formation across cosmic times? Because the ISM basically is the fuel, like the gas in the ISM is partially the fuel for star formation. So any evolution in the ISM has obviously some implication for the star formation process. And the third big question is, what is the effect of feedback, both from AGN and star formation on the ISM? So these three questions are very broad. I will touch upon every of them, but obviously maybe in detail we can discuss even offline. So let's start from the ISM, and I will try to convince you, if it's necessary, I don't know, that the ISM is really a complex environment. So let's have a look at this sketch. I just plot, I took a picture of a local, towards Orion bar. So it's a more or less 100 parsecs, more or less. And as you can see here, there are many things going on. So there is star formation. So you can see all big star clusters around. But the star formation and the young stars produce a huge amount of ionizing photons, so they create H2 regions. So H2 regions are important, and is one thing that you have to keep in mind when you study the complexity of the ISM. But this is just the beginning, because the ionizing photons create H2 regions, but there are a lot of 5B photons that actually dissociate molecules and create the so-called photodissociation regions. The photodissociation regions are super important because are the bridge, let's say, between the H2 regions and the molecular clouds. The molecular clouds are really the birthplaces of stars, and by themselves are really complex because they have an internal structure in density, they are turbulent, and what is going on within the giant molecular cloud happens on scales that are of the order of parsecs or fraction of parsecs. So like you really need to zoom in into DGMCs to understand the star formation process in the place where star formation is happening. But this is not the whole story, because these GMCs are embedded in a more diffuse gas, that is the diffuse neutral medium. There is dust in the ISM. Many people like here, I know, work on dust, and dust emission is really a hot topic, let's say, in this era with ALMA that allows to trace dust emission up to very high redshift. But unfortunately, I have to warn you that I won't touch very much on, like my talk won't be on dust emission. So remember that that's very important, but I won't talk about that very much. And then there is the diffuse ionized gas, which is also important. But then there is the feedback. So the stars explode, and the supernova explosion injects turbulence in the ISM. Obviously, there are also winds. There are many other feedback processes, but there is also the pollution of the ISM. So the metal injection is another thing that needs to be accounted for when you study the ISM evolution. It's not the whole story yet, because if you are in an environment where you are close to an AGM source, then obviously you have to like understand and consider the fact that AGM produce radiation, for instance, in the X-rays, among the all bands that we can talk about. And the X-rays that impact the molecular gas create the so-called X-ray dominated regions that have specific and peculiar emission properties that can be studied through molecular line mostly. So PDR and XDR are a big topic by themselves. So the details, if you are interested in into the details, we wrote recently a review with Mark Wolfire and Melanie Chevanche. So all the details on the physics and chemistry of PDR and XDR can be found there. But basically, there is a big and important point that needs to be accounted for when you think about the ISM in the IRSC universe, is that there is the CMB. So everything is embedded in the CMB, and especially for the lines that trace cold gas, this background is important and I cannot be neglected. So this is one thing that changes when you go towards higher airship. Now we are in the ALMA era, and we will be in the JWST era soon, we are already. So there are many lines that allow us to trace these gas phases. I will focus on some of, like, this is just a small fraction of all the possible lines. But I'm just mentioning the C plus because it's the like the king line faced by ALMA in the IRSC universe, which is basically coming from PDRs, but not only. It comes more or less from everywhere, but PDRs is important. Then there is the oxygen 388 micron, that is another line very interesting. And I will also talk a bit about the C3. And this is a line that will be a piece of cake for the WST, so very soon. And for the molecular gas, they are the CO lines. There are many other molecular lines, but the CO lines are obviously the more targeted in general. So what is the situation at the moment for the observation towards very high redshift, and especially for detection that have together different tracer for the ISM. So not only one line, but we are getting to the point that we have multiple lines and trace different gas phases. This is just really a summary. Maybe I miss someone, so I apologize in advance. But these are the galaxies that are jointly detected in oxygen 3 and C+, towards the epoch of ionization. And this is really the beauty of ALMA, because now we are really getting to a point where we see both the ionized gas and the neutral gas faced by the C+. The same is true for C3 and C+, but you can see the number of galaxies that are jointly detected at the moment is just 3, because the WST is not like working at the moment. So we have BLT or CAC data. And this is also interesting because these two are carbon lines. So you can be interested in understanding the ionization status of carbon and using a carbon tracer for the ionized gas and the carbon tracer for the neutral gas. So what is the situation? And how we can understand what is going on in this with this observation. Well, I am mostly a theoretician, but I work a lot also with observe. And basically what I've been doing since my PhD is developing ISM models and try to also implement them in cosmological simulation and doing simulation in order to understand if we expect an evolution in the gas density of the gas, in the gas density of the ISM, in the radiation field, in the molecular fraction, and everything that can affect the luminosity of the line we observe. Obviously, this is just an example. All the detail on the simulation, please have a look at this series of paper. And this is a suite that is called SERRE, and that they are zoom-in simulation that reach more or less 10 parsec resolution in the ISM of galaxies. Obviously, this is just one part of the story, because apart from the simulation, you really need to implement also ISM physics in post-processing, because you cannot really follow everything like from the beginning in simulation. And so I've been working mostly in implementing models for the C+ emission, so for the PDR, models for the CO emission, so for giant molecular clouds, And also, it's important to have a radiative transfer on the fly in order to trace the ionized gas and then try to understand what is going on with the lines that trace ionized gas, such as the oxygen 3 and the C3. And these are like some of the work that I have been doing, obviously in collaboration with all the people that developed the simulation and the observers that provide the beautiful data. So let's start from some open questions, because I promised you at the beginning to try to discuss a bit the evolution of the ISM. So if we see some kind of trends that are different now with respect to the IHCP universe, one thing that is seems to be like appearing from observation is that there is an indication that in EOR sources, the oxygen 3 over C plus line tend to be the luminosity ratio tend to be pretty high, even higher than dwarf galaxies that are generally thought to be the typical template for high-redshift galaxies in some sense. Obviously, these are triggered a lot of questions, because we want to understand if this is tracing a different C over O abundance, or there are different filling factors for the ionized versus neutral gas phase, or other things that evolve in the ISM of first galaxies. But one important thing to keep in mind is that, as shown by Carniani collaborators in 2020, if you study the size of the C plus versus the C2 line, it seems that more or less the size of the C plus is much the C plus is much more extended than oxygen 3. So partially, this high ratio could be due to some kind of observational bias. Maybe that's not the really right word. It's more like you might miss some of the C plus emission because it's below the sensitivity and is more extended. But this is a possibility, but even correcting for this fact, it seems that the ratio is still pretty high with respect to the local universe. And this is also related to another aspect that I will talk in 3 minutes, I guess. the fact that if you put the surface brightness, so not the total luminosity, the surface brightness of the C plus versus the sigma star formation rate surface density, you see that all the galaxies towards the EOR seems to be really below this spatially resolved relation. Obviously, again, it could be that could be an observational problem, because you might miss some part of the flux. That there might be problem in how you derive the star formation rate. So JWST also will help in this, but at the moment, this is pretty solid, or at least it seems to be there. So we try to understand if together this low C2 surface brightness and these high ratios are connected in some way. So what we have been doing recently is to focus on the sigma O3 over sigma C2 ratio. So not the luminosity ratio that I was talking before, but really the surface brightness ratio. Because when you take into account of the surface brightness ratio, in some sense, you already take into account of the different size of the emitting region. So you can be, and the ratio is more closely related to the local properties of the ISM. So we started from the simulation that I was mentioning before. So we have our high resolution simulation with the spatial resolution of 10 parsec, let's say, but we also applied some kind of beam smearing, so trying to reproduce the kind of observational setup that you might have with an ALBA observation, to try to understand if the sigma C2 we get from the simulation at high resolution is the same or not with respect to what you get when you consider of this observational smearing, let's say. So let's start from this plot. So this shows the sigma C2 versus sigma O3 for these are the local dwarf galaxies. And like the data are taken from the Luce collaborator 2014. Sorry if I didn't, there is no reference here. And this is the high redshift sample that I was mentioning before in my introduction. Then we also added our simulated galaxies. So we selected from the SARA simulation a sample of 20 galaxies, more or less with the same stellar mass. So we try to select galaxies that resemble more or less to the observation. And we put the sigma C2 versus sigma O3 in this plot at high resolution. So without taking into account of the observational setup, let's say. But then we did the other step and we say, okay, what if we consider instead of the observational, like the beam of ALMA observation? Well, everything gets shifted a bit towards lower values because you lose a bit of flux and the radius that you get maybe is overestimated, but the ratio, more or less, both lines are affected in the same sense. So the ratio is still more, you see that the shift is just along the line, so it's not up and down. So this seems to tell you that actually these high ratios are more or less physical, and this is something that is also clear when you plot point by point. So these crosses, the little crosses, are patches, 100 patches in the ISM of these high redshift galaxies. And you see that the distribution of these patches in the ISM have a peak, more or less, a luminosity weighted peak here, okay, which is pretty much close to where you will have a galaxy integrated overall. So what all this discussion is telling us, that actually high C2 oxygen 3 C plus ratio are not due to really like an observational bias, is mostly that you are really more sensitive to the more central and extreme part of the galaxies, but these patches exist in the ISM. They are not, the galaxy that you observe, you see that they stand close to the patches in the central, that come from the central part of the galaxy. So you are probing actually an ISM situation that is more connected to the central part, but is there in the galaxy. We want to do kind of a step more, because this is just what we get from this sample. But what if we use a model that is more holistic, let's say a bit like an analytical model that we developed over in the last couple of years, and that's been tested against the simulation also. So like they talk to each other. But so what if we find a way to describe the surface brightness of this line and connect them, connect the surface brightness of the line to three parameters that are really describing some fundamental properties of the ISM. And this is what we did. So we found a way to write the sigma C2, but also the other line, I will get there, as a function of three numbers. Obviously, it's a simplification, we know, but the first one is called burstiness parameter, and it's more or less a measure of how much bursty the galaxy is and how much you deviate from the Schmidt-Kennicott relation. So you have upward deviation with respect to the Schmidt-Kennicott relation, you are in a bursty situation. I will get back to this in a couple of slides. Then the gas density, so the mean gas density in the galaxy, and also the metallicity, because the metallicity and the abundance of metals is definitely important. We wrote the model for the C2, but also for the C3 and for the oxygen 3. Here I will talk about oxygen 3, but we have also a paper out for the C3. How these affect? So I try to explain why the trend, like this parameter affect the C2. So if you have, so this is a sketch. Imagine that you have the local relation and the galaxies in gray there are the high redshift galaxies that are below this sigma C2, sigma star formation rate relation. Then what happens if this KS parameter becomes greater than one? Well, the galaxy actually shift towards in this direction, okay? Why? Because with a starburst, you have a larger ionization parameter, more or less, this is the basic idea. So you have more ionized gas column densities, you have lower PDR column densities, so the C2 that is more related to the PDR is going down. This is really a simplification, but so I hope that is clear more or less the plan. The opposite is true for a line that actually takes the ionized gas because you are actually pumping the line in this situation. This is one of the parameters, but there is also the gas density. So the C2 sigma star formation rate relation, if you go towards the low density, goes in this direction, so goes down. This is not the whole story because there is also metallicity. And the metallicity actually change a bit the shape that you expect for the C2 sigma star formation rate relation. But basically with low metallicity, you also go down, but in a way that is at the beginning is a bit sublinear and then goes down, drop very quickly. So it's highly nonlinear. It's very tricky to really understand the metallicity of the ISM just from the C-class line because of this nonlinear trend with the Z. But what, like, okay, I have the model. I hope you are convinced that it's working, but why I want this, like I want to use this model to understand something. And actually this is possible because with three observable, actually you can put a constraint on three parameters, modulo the model that you have. And this is something that we developed in the last couple of years. And the code is also publicly available. So if you want to use the code because you have your favorite galaxy in C2 or maybe Oxygen 3, then you can download and run the MCMC and derive what? Well, the corner plot for the gas density, the metallicity, and this parameter that describe the deviation from the Smith-Seneca relation. These are just three examples of the galaxy that I was mentioning before. Just to let you know that this is the, like I selected this just because are pretty explicative in my opinion, because you see the KS, so this parameter in log is much high, like is even close to 100 in this situation. Obviously the bananas are pretty large, but it seems that overall the galaxies are all above this Smith-Seneca relation. The density is pretty high because if you think that the average density of these maps Y1 is 10 to the 3 is super high because this is just one number that describes the whole ISM. Obviously there are regions that could be at lower density, but overall you get a density that is again, pretty high. The metallicity is less constrained because of the trend that I was mentioning before. The interesting thing is that it seems that at least for this kind of object, we don't find like very low metallicity, like 1% solar, 2% solar, is already more or less, like if you think that some of them are at redshift 8 and you are at 30, 20% solar, 50% solar, it seems already pretty rich, the ISM. And this is actually connected to the fact that it's bursty. So our interpretation is that the burstiness of the ISM produce a lot of episodes of star formation, and then you pollute the ISM very quickly. The basically, this KS parameter is a number that can be related to the depletion time. It's the opposite, more or less, of the depletion time. So the higher is the KS, the shorter is the depletion time, because you have less gas for unit of star formation rate. And so we find that these numbers correspond to this very pretty short depletion time, so between 6 and 49 mega years. They are very, very short, at least in the episode that we are observing now. But this is just an indication from an indirect method. This model is an indirect model. And the tricky part here is, okay, maybe we can use this model, but what about really tracing the Smith-Kanikat relation with CO? Because generally what we do is to trace the molecular gas with the molecular lines. So this is an indirect method, but what do we know about the CO? Well, actually the galaxy on the right, so this one, has been targeted by Hashimoto and collaborators. You can find on archive, and the name is Big Tree Dragons, so like it's also a funny name. And actually they didn't detect the CO. So they try to put constraint on the depletion time with many methods, but basically the range that they find obviously is an upper limit. And is again, is not so, like, okay, they are, here is much like 10 times higher than the numbers we get, but it can be as short as 2.5 mega years. So it's like the indication also that you don't detect the CO can be related to the fact that you are exhausting this molecular gas very quickly in some sense. And this is exactly the same galaxy that we analyzed with our model. But this is not, so the key question here is what about the evolution of the Smith-Kanikat relation? So we are really seeing an evolution in the Kanikat-Schmidt or not? We are at the beginning of this. Here I just plot one of the most recent derivation at redshift zero by Federico Esposito that is working here in Bologna. But basically this is just to show you that he put together also a sample of Cepher galaxies to see if we see some kind of displacement with respect to normal galaxies. But more or less the work from Federico shows that in the local universe, at least, even like if you put Cepher galaxies, they are all more or less aligned on the same relation of like other galaxies that are not active, they don't have AGN. So it seems that there is no real impact of the AGN, this is something that also relates to the fact that depletion time in the low redshift universe are much longer. Because if you see instead the line of the 30 mega year depletion time, I plot by myself now, it's not in the paper, but it's much higher. So, and we don't have galaxies at least in the sample of Federico that goes in that direction. But actually, this is a plot that has been produced from the Serra simulation that I was mentioning before. And what we find actually is that in our sample of simulated galaxies, we have an overall, the KS, so this parameter that describes the deviation from the Smith-Kanikat is consistently above one. So there seems to be a kind of an evolution. Obviously, probably the numbers that we find and that I was mentioning before are a bit an outlier also for our simulation. That might be that we are observing the more busty one at the moment with ALMA. We don't, it's still open for discussion. But overall, it's clear that the old galaxies that we select from our simulation, and these are kind of normal galaxies. The halo mass is 10 to the 11, so it's they are like Lehmann Bragg galaxies, not quasars, let's say, not rare object. They are above the local relation. So this is up for new observation, new studies, because this is a theoretical prediction, but we are getting this kind of behavior from different angles. So it seems that something we are seeing something there, and it's worth analyzing what happens. But how much time I do? Yeah, just
10 minutes.
Okay. So I have enough time for the last part of the talk. So basically, the problem is that if you want to trace in the IAF shift universe directly the Smith-Kanikat relation, so tracing the molecular gas with the CO, Then you need really to model the excitation of CO, because basically what Federico and other people that study the local relation in the Smith Calicut relation do is to observe CO1 to 0, CO2 to 1, to test the whole, the cold diffuse molecular gas, like the whole mass reservoir, okay? But this is possible, like this is very tricky for a high redshift universe because of the CMB that I was mentioning before. And also because if you want to go there with ALMA, ALMA, like the first line that you can get from redshift above 6 is the CO 6 to 5, I guess, so 5 to 4. So you are already in the mid-J range, let's say. And this, when you start to go to a mid-J and high-J CO lines range, then you really need to be very careful in the modeling of the excitation and the effect of shocks, X-rays, and like possibly strong radiation fields that can like make this CO sled, is the name, varying a lot. And when you observe the line here, for instance, the CO 6 to 5 in the high redshift universe, and you want to go back to the total molecular mass, you need to convert to the 1 to 0. So the excitation is an important like quantity, and you need to have an handle of this. A way to approach this is to study in the local universe some different type of galaxies with different, for instance, X-ray radiation. And this has been done by several people in the local universe, but also in the for high redshift quasars. And the whole story is that we want to understand if high JCO lines really like have the imprint of the X-ray radiation, possibly from AGN or other mechanisms happening in the ISM, in order to then convert to the actual CO total molecular mass. So this CO detection, as I was mentioning before, at the moment in the EOR, actually are several quasars. Here I just mentioned some of them. There is Roberto quasars, but there are like many others working on that. So we have several CO detection, high JCO line, mid JCO lines. So in quasar, it seems doable. Okay. In the range of normal galaxies, more kind of normal galaxies, there is a CO 2 to 1 by Pavesi in this galaxy that now is detecting all the line that I mentioned. So apart from, so it's a good candidate to be targeted again. And then there is this one that is in a line membrane galaxies as a work still submitted done by a Japanese team. To my knowledge, these are the only normal galaxy at the moment detected in CO 6 to 5. While the quasars obviously are observed. So like what we are observing now, we are really witnessing the effect of the AGN or like the accretion onto the central black hole that is pumping in some way a bit more these lines, or is just that they are more massive, so more luminous and so easier to be detected. This is up for discussion. And actually, this is really the very last part of my talk. So one possibility, and as I was mentioning before in my introduction, is to really go and see the GMC, so the molecular cloud distribution, and try to model very in detail the internal structure of GMC and the interaction with X-ray radiation. And this is what I did in Leiden with Xander Tierens when I went there for my Marie Curie. So we started to think about XDR models applied to a distribution of GMC in a galaxy. But the GMCs, so this is just the distribution we had. So it's just we put the GMC on a disk and then changing a bit the profile or the size of the galaxy, the X-ray luminosity, the obscuration of the torus and many other quantities, the mean density of the GMC. But the GMC are not just one point, they have an internal distribution of densities, because we know in the local universe that the molecular clouds are really a collection of clumps and cores. And the turbulence is really affecting the distribution of densities in these molecular clouds. So each cloud in the model actually is a collection of clumps, as shown here in this very simple sketch. But this is not the final thing, because for each cloud, then we want to see, okay, what is the luminosity of CO, for instance, that is produced by a GMC with a given distribution of density and illuminated by X-ray radiation, far UV radiation from star formation, and things like that. And this is done by post-processing this analytical model for the GMC with cloudy models that determine the CO emission as a function of the various different properties of the gas. Gas density, again, radiation field, column densities, metallicity, and whatever you have in mind for a molecular cloud. Turbulence, because the Mach number is connected to the affected distribution of the clumps within the GMC. And basically, putting everything together, so putting the molecular clouds in this disk, we produced some kind of prediction for the CO excitation as a function of the parameters that I was mentioning 3 minutes ago. So what we found, so let's start from the upper left plot here. So this is a normalized, so a CO slab normalized to the 3-2-2, but I mean, you can do like normalizing whatever line, but basically as expected, if we keep increasing the X-ray luminosity at the center, we find actually a kind of enhancement in the high J CO line, because high J is above 10, let's say. So this is something that is telling you that probably partially the X-ray radiation is important, but as you can see, the larger effect actually, you see here there is an enhancement, a dramatic enhancement, and this is produced by the fact that if you put all the GMCs much closer to the center of the AGN, because the galaxy high redshift are much smaller, then the effect is enhanced, because the flux that is X-ray flux that might see modulo the absorption, that is a tricky business, is higher, the X-ray flux, and so you pump the X-ray radiation and seen by the GMC, and you pump the CO emission. Finally, we also tested a bit with an analytical model, the obscuration of the torus, so if it's aligned with the disk of the galaxy, or if it's like 90 degrees tilted. And obviously, the more you expose the GMCs to the X-ray, so the tilt is higher, the more, so the AGN obscuration is decreasing at the end, so this is the meaning of this plot, the more you pump this CO emission. But there is the last difficult part, is the density, because in any GMC, if you go and take two equal GMCs, but for the density, if you take the denser, obviously you pump more the IJCO line. So this is not a problem, but it's something that is telling you that in the high redshift universe where the galaxies are much denser, you might have also an enhancement in the IJCO line, apart from the X-ray radiation, just because the gas is denser and the CO is pumped more in the IJCO lines. So this is another example on how the ISM is complex and in.
Sorry, that is the density of the cloud, right?
Exactly, the mean density of the
of each cloud.
Of each cloud, exactly. To be honest, this is, I didn't put the numbers, I'm sorry. So this is this range to from 10 to the 2, I guess 10 to the 5 or something like that. Sorry, this is I just realized. But so X-ray luminosity goes from 10 to the 42 to 10 to the 45. And the galaxy goes, so this is a galaxy with the smaller one is 200 parsec radius. Okay, so 250, so 500 parsec diameter. That is really a bit the limit of, we see some of them in simulation, but these are not, maybe not quasars, but just normal galaxies, but this size that are not pretty small is possible. So sorry for missing numbers. And this is basically as a function of the angle. So if it's zero, the torus is alineated with the disk. If it's 90 degrees, it's totally not alineated, like perpendicular. yeah, so I mean, the complexity I was mentioning at the beginning is definitely coming back also in this kind of models for the single GNCs. So the more line you have, the more spatial resolution you have, the more simulation you have, the more you can discover if it's really like evolving the ISM or if you have some kind of observational bias. So I guess I have the possibility of answering partially the questions, partially, because what are the differences between the ISM properties in local with respect to high redshift galaxies? Well, high redshift galaxies are overall denser, more turbulent. Sorry, I didn't mention, but in the simulation we have also the Mach numbers and are much higher than what we observe in the local universe, and more compact. And this affects the line emission and especially the C+ and CO from molecular clouds. What are the implications for star formation across cosmic time? Well, the data means of a possible evolution in cosmic time accretion, but galaxies are overall more vasty. So the ratios might be higher because of that. This is our interpretation. But again, high spatial resolution will clarify better if we are somehow missing some flux around the galaxies. And finally, what is the effect of feedback on the ISM and on the molecular gas? Well, there is a possible effect of AGM in the CO excitation, but need to be further addressed with observation, really, in two different kind of galaxies. So quasars, but also normal galaxies, to see if we keep seeing some kind of different enhancement. And we still don't have the IGCO line in normal galaxies. So that's a problem. And also, if we want to directly trace the Kanikal-Schmidt relation, we need to understand the CO excitation, because the CO needs to be converted from the 6 to 5 or whatever other line to the 1 to 0. So these are just a few answers. I guess many others are still very open. And I thank you for the attention.